woman, infant and suckling, ox and sheep, camel and ass. And Saul smote the Amalekites. King Saul. He smote the Amalekites from Havilah until thou comest to Shur, that is over against Egypt. And he took Agag, the king of Amalekites, alive. But that's not what God said to do. He said to kill everybody, right? Right? Is that what he said? So here's the disobedience right here. And he took Agag, the king of Amalekites, alive and utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep and of the oxen and of the fatlings and the lambs and all that was good, and would not utterly destroy them, but everything that was vile and refuse, that they destroyed utterly. Now, when I read this a few weeks ago, I never really made the connection between the two in reading this story before. Never really made the connection until now. It's good to see you. I thought you looked familiar from Breaking Chains. It's good to see you. I never made the connection until recently. But the Bible account for Esther, a cycle was broken that started more than 500 years prior to her. In approximately 1025 BC, God told King Saul to completely destroy the Amalekites. But Saul disobeyed. We read that just now in 1 Samuel chapter 15. But if we flip through the scriptures just a little bit more, just a little bit down past there, we come to the book of Esther chapter 9 verses 24 and 25. And it says, because Haman, the son of Hammedatha, the Agite, the enemy of all the Jews, have plotted against the Jews to annihilate them. Just like the devil has planted to get rid of some of us in here tonight. He plotted against us. He plotted to kill us way back when we were little. And that's what started the generational cycle. He's had it out for us since we were little, since we were babies, since we were in our mother's womb. The devil has had it out for us. But tonight, how many of you know he lost that battle?
Amen.
He lost that battle because you're sitting here right now. You're not in here just for a meal tonight. So it's not by accident that you're sitting here tonight. Now, this is what happened. So he cast the plot a lot, which means he cast money. He made a bet to consume and destroy them. He made a bet on how many he can destroy and when that can happen. But in verse 25, it says this, when Esther came before the king, he commanded by letter that this wicked plot, which Haman had devised against the Jews, should return on his own head. So what happened was Haman devised a plot to hang all the Jews. That was his plot. So what God did is he came in as a cycle breaker through Ruth to change that, and had that same thing that he was going to do come back on his head. And that he and his son should be hanged on the gallows. Now, Saul's failure to obey is what started that generational cycle. But some of us in here tonight has a different cycle that needs to be broken outside of what I just read to you about Haman with the Jews. Some of us has had generational cycles that started when we were younger. Some of our family members have been dealing with poverty. I don't know who that was. Poverty. It's a cycle. It's a cycle that we go through. It's a generational cycle. But how many of you know that that can change tonight? With just a spoken word. Just a spoken word. A little bit of time. And because of poverty, it opened up the door for a whole lot of other things. It opened up the door for depression. How many of you in here tonight have been dealing with depression? Depression is a demonic thing. Depression is a generational thing. Depression is a cycle that happens within our families, been passed down from generation to generation to generation to generation to generation. So the cycles that we're going through, it doesn't seem like we have help sometimes. Don't let me go too far. Don't let me go too far. It seems like a cycle thing that you can't get away from. And as you can see, I can't go too far from anything. Why? Because the things that have attached itself to me through my past has held me bound. So because of depression, I needed to medicate. So what did I do? Turn to alcoholism. And I started to drink my problems away. Why? Because I thought that alcoholism would help. I thought drinking alcohol would help. I thought doing these things and tossing back a 40 and sitting at the bar tossing back Jack and Cokes would help me. But all it did was put a band-aid on it. I'm telling you my testimony. Everything I'm calling out right now is my testimony. Everything I'm calling out right now is what has happened to me. So this is a part of me being transparent. So as you can see, the strings are getting tighter. So at the further and the harder I try to go forward in life, because of the things that are still attached to me, I can't go. So what happens after that? It opens up the door to what? Drugs and alcohol. Drugs. My addiction, because the alcohol couldn't do it. So what did I need? I need to find something stronger to put a band-aid on all that other stuff. Now listen, hear me. Just because I'm a Christian doesn't mean I don't deal with anything. Just because I'm a Christian doesn't mean I'm perfect. I still deal with things every day. But I understand that it's the grace of God that keeps me where I am today. I understand that it's the grace of God that allows me to be here today. So after the drugs come into place, what happens after that? It opens up more doors, and as I can see, I'm getting a little loose on this side. But as you can see, these lines are tight. And I'm trying to go forward. I'm trying to make something happen in my life. I'm trying to get a good job. I'm trying to be productive in life. I'm trying to save up money. I'm trying to do something better for my kids. I'm trying to go forward, but these things keep holding me back. So after that happens, and now I have alcohol. I have depression. I have poverty. I have drugs. That opens the door to what? Sexual abuse, because now you're looking for love in all the wrong places and you can't find it because the things have your mind clouded, because the adversary has tricked you into seeing things that is not there. The adversary has tricked you into thinking that your cycle is just a season. But how many of you here know that a season has a start time and an end time? The summertime is a season. It has a start and it has an end. But what we fail to see is that sometimes those seasons become a cycle. Because the people that comes into our lives, the people that comes into our lives to set us free, we ignore. So what happens? We go and we try to fight, and then things are getting tight and tighter and tighter. So before you know it, it's starting to choke off your very oxygen. It's starting to choke you out of everything. And now you're starting to feel hopeless. But guess what? It just doesn't start with you. Because now your children are involved. Now this is a God thing. Because now your children are involved. And who has the other one? Now that your children are involved, whatever was attached to you is now attached to them. But here's the crazy thing. This is my daughter. And she's with child. She has my grandbaby. She has our grandbaby on the way. So you see what I'm saying? It's not just affecting me. It's affecting my daughter. And now it's affecting my grandchildren. Why? Because when I had the opportunity to get rid of those cycles and break and destroy those cycles, I ignored the call of God to come and separate. So now the further that she tried to go with her grandbaby, what? Those things keep holding her back. Why? Because I had the opportunity to deal with those things, but I push the opportunity away. Why? Because I thought I can do it on my own. Why? Because I have friends attached to me that said, oh man, you don't need that church tonight. You don't need to go to church. You don't need to go to feed my sheep tonight. You don't need to go in there and hear the word. Here, come drink this 40 with me. Here, come drink this, smoke this blunt with me. No. You want to do something better in your life? You want to go somewhere? You got to stop doing the same thing you've been doing every day. Right. It's time to stop and break that cycle. But that cycle only breaks when you take the initiative to step out. So what happens after that? You come in here on a Tuesday night and you start receiving the word. So then God sends somebody into you. Maybe he's not here. Maybe he's in Walmart. Maybe he's walking up and down the hilltop. Maybe you're sitting over your friend's house at a barbecue and God sends somebody by to come and talk to you and begins to pour into you. And then your heart's opened up and you're able to hear what he's saying. So he tells you, come with me on a Tuesday night to Hilltop, feed my sheep. There's something there that you need. So when you come in here expecting to hear something, the guy comes in, He gets up here to preach like I'm doing right now. And as he's preaching to you, he begins speaking to those things in your life that has been binding you, that has been keeping you from moving forward. Man, these guys are pretty strong. I can feel it cutting off my... Good God today. But as you can see, I can't go nowhere. And if I can't go nowhere, my grandbaby can't go nowhere. Are you hearing what I'm saying tonight? So if you're a Christian or not, if you got soul ties, things change that still connect you to you, tonight's your opportunity to get prayer and get free from those things. Can I get a hallelujah?
Hallelujah!
Can I get a hallelujah?
Hallelujah!
Are you feeling what I'm saying tonight?
Yes.
Are you hearing the message tonight? Yes. I told you I'm not going to be before you long. Ain't no Christian in here perfect.
Amen.
And I'm going to stand up here and say I'm the last person that should be up here preaching. But God gave me an assignment tonight. Because I've been where you are. All these things that's tied and connected to me right now, this is my testimony. I went to alcoholism. I was in a mindset of poverty. I was depressed and tried to kill myself. I went to alcohol, trying to cover it up and try to get rid of the pain from being molested when I was younger. I used those things. I even went and started smoking weed. And I'm not a weed smoker, man. I'm a drinker. I'm just going to let you know. Man, I don't know. And I'm just like, there's something very wrong with it because it opens the door. Drugs and alcohol opens the door for the devil to slip in. So when the guy comes and he begins to preach to you and begins to minister to you, what happens? He begins to break off those things from you. So now I can move a little bit more. And then he comes and he quotes scripture to you and he begins to pray for you. And then he begins to minister to you and he follows up to you. And then one day he comes and says, hey, would you like to go get a cup of coffee? Let's sit down. Then what happens? Some more breaks off. And now I'm getting free. And now those things that used to bind me can't bind me no more. And because now I'm free, now my grandbaby's free. Now my daughter is free. And now she can go on and live her life because now I'm free from what I dealt with. Some of us in here as adults got children. Those things, if you don't stop those things tonight, it's going to carry on to the next generation. Tonight is your opportunity to do that. So as he begins to sit down with me and have coffee, I open up my Bible and I begin to read Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And then the man that's preaching to me, that's creating a relationship with me, begins to explain to me that God is a good father. He's our shepherd. And he's there to give us whatever we want, but he's not our spiritual errand boy. He's there to help us live a better life. So as he begins to do that, something else gets free from me. And now that thing that was tied to me, I no longer have a part of. And I can keep moving forward. I can take a few more steps forward in victory. But I can't go no more further. Why? Because I still got two more things tied up. So what happens with that? I get connected to some good brothers that have surrounded me. I get together with some good sisters that have been with me. Been with, if I was a female, that's praying for me, that's pouring into me, speaking life into me, pouring into me more than I'm taking from them and not draining me of who I am. And that's what Jesus does. He pours more into you because he knows what you're all about. He knows your character. He knows who you are because he knew you from your mother's womb. He knew you way before you were conceived. So he knows what's best for you. Jeremiah 29:11 said, for I know the thoughts that I have for towards you, thoughts to prosper you. And at the end he said, not to harm you, to give you an expected end. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
So as I'm reading these scriptures, now I'm getting energized, now I'm pumped. Now I can go out and say, my brother, I know somebody else that can help you through your situation. I know a man that knows everything you've been through, but he still loves you. Why? Because he gave his life for you. And now that I'm sharing my testimony with somebody else and I'm speaking into it, guess what else happens as we're doing that? Something else gets broken loose.
Amen.
We got skin in the game. We got skin in the game. What's your name?
Benny.
No. What did the title give you?
Drugs.
Drugs.
Nobody.
Drugs. You think it's by accident this is the last one?
No.
Not by any chance at all. Because sometimes we get those friends in our life. Keep it tight. We get those friends in our life. Even though we're Christians, even though we've given our hearts to the Lord, we still got those connections to our friends from the past. They call up, hey Dave, what you doing tonight? I'm telling you my story. Hear me. I'm telling you my story. If I'm lying, I'm dying. My wife has hurt. My wife has been with me for 24 years.
Amen.
She's seen this happen. Dave, what you doing tonight, man? I'm sitting at home chilling with my family. Hey, you want to go to this club? What club is this? The strip club off of Cleveland. Nah, man, I'm good. Well, man, don't be a punk. Come on, let's go. Okay, I'll ride with you, babe. I'll be back. Lie. I told her I was going to go hang out at his house. Lie. That's the first one. Open up the door. Then what did I do? I went to go hang out with him at the strip club. Why? Because I'm still connected to that guy that was bringing me back. Keep pulling, keep pulling. That's bringing me back from reaching my goal and from getting closer to God. So when the guy comes back and he asks me, how have you been? I haven't seen you in church for a while. I haven't heard from you, okay? And because I feel convicted about what has happened, I have to tell him, I went back and started hanging out with my friends again. Can you pray for me? I will ask for forgiveness. And so I asked for forgiveness. And then God shows up and he said, because you had the strength to come and apologize and repent, this is what I want you to do. I want you to go back to that same person and minister to him. Minister into him, pour into him, pray for him. And then what happens after that? When you're strong enough to do that, you get freed. You get freed. And now you're walking free. And see all this right here I'm pulling off? This is just a residue. Where's he at? There it is. This is the residue. But see, even with that, God gave me the strength to pull that off.
Oh my God.
The residue. The residue. The residue that only God can take away. And how does that come? How do you get rid of that residue? By staying in your word. By staying in your Bible. By being on your face before the Lord and praying. Because let me tell you something. Those things will come. Those temptations will come back. Because scripture tells us that even though you're free, sin lieth at the door waiting for you. Just like the seeds that went out on a good ground, stony ground, the fertile ground. What happened when they went out? The birds came around and started eating up the seed. So here's a seed for you tonight. You have the ability tonight to get free. Don't walk out that door the same way. Don't walk out the door the same way. God wants to free you, and he's here to do that for you. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Thank you for your time, and I appreciate you. God loves you, and so do I. That's it. So if you want prayer, if you want to be free tonight, I told you I wasn't going to be long. I think that's the quickest message I've ever preached. But it was impactful. It was impactful, because you can get free. Actually, I was going to ask you to come up and help me. Because having a little one that way, oh my God, this is so much impactful to see how the decisions that we make right now affect our children, our grandchildren, their children. So as for me, my goal is to break every cycle that has been attached to me, every generational thing that has been attached to me, so that my children's children's children don't have to go through the same thing that I went through. So if that's you tonight and you want to get free from that, I'm here to pray for you and help you along that way. But it takes a willing heart, it takes faith in Jesus, and it takes you confessing that Jesus is Lord in your life in order for that process to start. So if you're willing to do that tonight, I'm here right now. We will pray for you. Let me go ahead and pray over this food real quick. And then if you want prayer, you want to give your heart to the Lord tonight to start that process of breaking off those cycles and those chains, I'm right here. If you're a female and you'd rather have a female pray for you, Pastor Christopher wouldn't mind coming up to pray with you. Amen?
Amen.
So, Father, in Jesus' name, God, we thank you for this message. We thank you, God, for the hearts that was impacted by the message. We thank you, God, for showing up in this place and for this opportunity. God, we trust, oh God, that through your power, through your grace, that everything that is attached to us, oh God, that does not look like you, will be broken off tonight. God, and when we wake up in the morning, we can begin to walk in new light and walk in a new life. God, we give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. God bless this food that we're about to receive. Use it for the nourishment of our bodies. God bless the hands that has prepared it, Father God. Bless the volunteers that have come in to serve it. Bless, oh God, those, oh God, who have put in the time and the work to be here tonight. God, I pray a hundredfold blessing on all the refuge guys that have helped and volunteered for this message tonight. God, whatever it is, Lord, that they're dealing with, whatever cycles that need to be broken in their life, God, whatever chains that need to be broken in their life, God, I speak to those chains right now in the name of Jesus, and those chains are destroyed, that they can walk out the calling that's on their lives. God, and I speak that over everyone that's under the sound of my voice and every mother's child in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah.